Okay, good morning, everybody. Been totally thrown by Cademan back and starting the clock on time. Cademan, you've forgotten some of the old traditions. We've started at 10:30, and it's, I don't know how you feel about it, but it's thrown me. But it's not a bad thing. It's not a bad thing, is it? It's 10:30, and welcome. The room will be fuller than this in 20 minutes' time, I predict. I will just make a little notice that Joseph and Emily are visiting us. Ooh, give them a round of applause, and I'll tell you why to give them a round of applause in case you don't know. But they're part of the church. Lockdown happened, and they had the nerve to move away during lockdown and get married. So I think this is the first time I've met you as husband and wife, I think. Maybe. But it's lovely to have you here with us. They're in Bristol now, but it's great to have you here. Okay, welcome, everybody. I'll do that again. If you're a visitor here, you are especially welcome. If this is your church and you've been around for years, then obviously you are just as welcome too. We haven't done this, maybe ever, but when I was growing up, one of the things that you did to prove that you were a Christian was you had memory verses. Anybody ever have this kind of childhood? Yes. Memory verses, and then you had to stand up the front of church and recite them, and if you could do 10 or something, you got into heaven. I can't remember the rules, but it was a good thing to do memory verses. And today, there is no Sam here. There is no Fran. There is no Jonathan Vinen. Thank goodness that Claire is here as a responsible adult in the room, because I don't know what's going on most of the time. And so I'm feeling slightly kind of, where do I look when I need to remember things? None of them are here. So Claire, it's really a lot of pressure on you today to make sure that we get through this. But I am unfortunately leading and speaking. It's not too late to go now if you want to. You could sneak out during the singing. But what I want to do, Ron, I was joking, stay there. What I want to do is just have one theme that we keep coming back to. Sometimes we have a sort of first part of the service and then we tell you what we're going to be speaking about. Well, I just want to have one theme, and it's this. If you can give me the screen, Cademan. One verse that says this: now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we're going to come back to that verse time and time again. But you are going to memorize it, okay? And this is how we're going to do it. A little bit of action helps. I haven't thought this through very well. Emily, if I'd known you were coming, I'd have got you to do this. But here we go. I want you to put your two hands up like this. And one of your hands is the Spirit. The other hand is the Lord. And for the Lord, we are thinking two things here. We're thinking Father God and Jesus Christ, okay? The Lord. And we're thinking Spirit. And very often, we see those things as separate. And so when we read, or when we say together, now the Lord is the Spirit, we're going to bring our two hands together. And I want you to squeeze them together so that they are indivisible, together, inseparable, one thing. Does that make sense? And then when we say, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. We're going to open our hands like that. Is that okay? And so we're going to say this a few times. And every time I say the word now, between now and 12 o'clock, you're going to burst into this. This is a terrible idea because the word now comes up occasionally. I'll say it deliberately and you'll know I'm meaning to say it. When I say now, we will say the verse together. So let's take the words off the screen. I've got to remember this. Okay, leave it up. Let's have a little practice. So let's say it together. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Have you got that? So let's have a little practice without the words on the screen. People coming in are going to go, wow, how do these guys know this? They're so good and godly. So we're going to, if you guys coming in, all I said was 2 Corinthians 3:17, and people now said this. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Okay? That's what we're going to be thinking about today. We're in this little series thinking about what does life in the Spirit look like? And today we're going to be thinking about, well, one of the things that life in the Spirit looks like is freedom. I wonder how free you feel today. The chances are, if you're not used to being in this room, you're a bit anxious. Maybe you don't feel sort of very free. You don't know who you've sat next to. And all the rest of it, you don't know what's going to be happening in the next little while. Perhaps if you've been here so many times, you're not very free either, because you're in a routine of just turning up and expecting that you do know what's going to happen. So let's just take a minute before we pray together and we sing some songs together to just pause and think, how free do I feel today? Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Now, the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Oh, that came so naturally and flowed so beautifully. I was about to say the word now. So what we're going to do now is I want you to think about being free. And often people sort of have said to me over the years, you know, I love one church, but when we're together, it doesn't always feel very free. You know, I'm used to some sort of behavior or actions that I've seen in other churches that I don't always see here. I'm not sure that's freedom either. But freedom looks like freedom for you. And what does freedom look like for you today? Maybe you need to just feel free to be at home and at peace here. You need to feel free to stay seating if Mark says, shall we stand together? You need to feel free to join in the singing and absolutely go for it. You need to feel free to move your feet and dance if you want to do that. You need to feel free to go out and get some air. You need to feel free. That's what I want you to think about today. How free do you feel? What are the thoughts and systems and atmosphere around you that is stopping you being free today? Because the Spirit brings freedom, and we trust that the Spirit is here in this place, in this room, that the Spirit has been with you in every moment of every day this week, in every moment of your life. The Spirit is there whispering to you, be free. Be free today. Be free today. That's what we want. So if you'd like to stand, please stand. And we often say a prayer together as we begin. And I'm going to say the words in black on the screen. And if you can say the words in orange, they kind of extend this thought about us being free together. Caveman, thank you. And then we're going to sing together. The Lord be with you and also with you. Hear these words of invitation. Welcome to the joyful. May you be able to share that joy here. Welcome to the tired and weary. May you find rest here. Welcome to the lonely. May you find community here. Welcome to the sick. May you find healing here. Welcome to those who mourn. May you find comfort here. Welcome to the foreigner, to the stranger, to the refugee. May you find safety here. Welcome to every nation, every race, every sexual orientation, every gender identity. May you find hospitality here. The God who delights in all of creation. This is us. Let's do this again. The God who delights in all of creation is in our midst. Thanks be to God. Amen.
When there's nothing good in me, you are love on display for all to see. You are light when the darkness closes in. You are hope, you have covered all my sin. You are peace when my fear is crippling. You are true, even in my wandering. You are joy, you're the reason that I sing. You are life, in you death has lost its sting. And oh, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever reign. are more, you are more than my words will ever say. You are Lord, you are Lord, all creation will proclaim. You are here, in your presence I'm made whole. You are God, of all else I'm letting go. And oh, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever reign. My heart will sing. No other name, Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing, no other name, Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing, no other name. I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever reign. I'm running to your arms. I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love. Your mercy never fails me, and all my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire in darkest night. You are close like no other. I have known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life lay down. I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God.
Now, the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Some people have just come in and think we're in some kind of cult, but we did practice that earlier, I promise you. So we're going to try that again. Those of you who have just come in, this is our memory verse for the day. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. So let's just try that again. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. I want you to say hello to someone around you, and that's always a bit embarrassing or not, but just be friendly, be free. You can be free to be unfriendly, you really can. You could do that and say, speak to the hand. But stop being friendly for now, because I want you to do a little job for me, which is I want you to think about freedom. What does freedom look like? What does freedom look like? If I said to you, I know somebody and they live their life so freely, what do you think I'm talking about? If you say that person has real freedom in their life, what does that look like? It might be easier to talk about what's the opposite of having a life that's free? Or it might be easy to just go with it and talk about what does freedom look like? Is that okay? And that's going to help us as we continue to think about the Spirit bringing freedom. You've got 3.5 minutes to say hello to somebody and to talk about, to nail down freedom. Go for it. Okay, I'm going to interrupt you there. Right, let's just get a little bit of feedback to help kind of get us into this thought. I'm going to be speaking on it later, but as I always say, I'm just sharing some thoughts with you, and my hope would be is that the most inspirational moment that happens today isn't from anything I say, but is from something that maybe you've chatted with about or something that you go away further and think about. But now, the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. So tell me, what does that mean? What does freedom mean? Somebody give me some feedback. Oh. Living without fear. I'm not going to walk around. It's way too hot and I'm sweating too much already. If you can shout and I'll repeat it. Ian's getting nominated. Do you want to be nominated, Ian? Is that? Having as many biscuits as you want. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is many biscuits. Georgie. Free to be in the present. Brilliant. Yeah. Did you hear that? That was really helpful. Free from social expectations, but in other societies. Finish that sentence. There are other types of freedom that are even more important. Yeah, Justin. Freedom from addiction. Great. Giving up nicotine, pushing marshmallows. That's your system. I know your game. James. Taking risk. Following intuition. Free to follow your intuition and take risk. Anne? Did you have your hand up? No. Great. Good stuff. Continue to chew that over. What does it mean to be free? Right, I've got some notices for you. And the first one, I'm going to invite Willow and Rose to come up. Let's give these guys a round of applause as they come up. Because it's scary standing in front of you guys. Woo! And they're going to tell us about something that they're doing. Let me move this out of the way so we can see you, all right? Who's going to go first? Which one of you is going to tell us what you're up to today? Come and stand here so we can see you.
Well, we are doing a cake sale and the money's going to go to plant trees and we're going to give half of it to go to Ripple Africa so that they can plant trees in Africa.
Brilliant. You're going to give half of it to planting trees in Africa, and what about the other half?
We're going to plant it here.
Plant here. And whose idea was this?
Well, it was mine and Rose's.
Amazing. And why do you think it's important, Rose? Do you want to tell us why you think it's important to do it?
Because if we don't look after our planet, then there's no planet B to go to.
Very good. So what can people do today?
Well, they can stop putting stuff in plastic bags. They can use paper bags or reuse stuff that they was using. And they can start planting trees more often.
Yep. Brilliant. And cakes have been snaffled up pretty quickly, like hot cakes. There's some sort of analogy for hot cakes going quickly. So they've sold really well already, but there's some at the back there, so people can come and buy them, and you're going to use that money to do that brilliant thing. That's amazing. Anything else you want to tell us? No? What about if people here thought over the coming weeks they could bring cake and put it at the back and put something to collect and give it to you for more cakes? Would that be a good idea? Brilliant. And maybe another week when you're bored and you've got time on your hands, you could make more cakes and do it again. Is that all right? Brilliant. Is that all clear? Brilliant. Fantastic. Give these guys a round of applause. I'm going to talk about this later, but freedom is so much more than just my personal freedom. What about freedom for our planet to breathe and to be and to live intuitively as it wants to? How do we help that to happen? So thank you, girls, for doing that. That's so inspiring and a great thing to do. Let me just tell you about a couple of other quick things. One of them is that this feels like it comes around very quickly, but every month we have a community meal, we call it. It's a meal where we serve people who are homeless or have accommodation issues or are just lonely and isolated. And it's kind of no questions asked. The hall is packed with people and we serve this incredible meal. But we need helpers to do that. So many people have helped. There is something about the third Sunday of the month, which is our Sunday, where every significant event in the calendar seems to happen on the third Sunday of the month. It's Father's Day today. Dealt with that. A couple ago, it was Mother's Day on the same day. So people might be doing stuff for Father's Day. I understand that. But today, if you can stick around and help, you'd be really, really welcome to. You get the benefit of helping, and you get the benefit of eating a lovely meal together. So if you can do that, come and speak to me. Equally, Alice, stand up a second. Let's just look at you. Alice has been out in the sun far too much, as we can see. Get a job, and Alice is going to take on... Somebody called Paul has been doing the admin sort of for that for years, and we're so grateful to Paul, but this is the last one he's doing it for. And Alice is going to be the person who sends out the reminder emails, who you go to say, actually, I'd like to be part of that team. And Paul does this amazing job of corralling us all in the room together to give us jobs and remind us what we're doing. So we're so grateful to Paul and Alice. But... please, if you can't make it today, sign up with Alice for future times. And it would be so good if we just got the rota full and happening so that every time it comes around, we didn't have to say, is there people able to help today? But you can smell it, can't you? The meal that's being cooked. So if you can help, that would be really, really good. Two other things. Next Sunday, we don't have a service here. We have these feasts every 6 weeks or so to mark a significant point that we are, as a planet, traveling around the sun. And at this point, next week, we will have got to the point where we're tilted the closest towards the sun, and we have the longest day of the year on the 21st, and it's called the summer solstice. And we're going to celebrate that by having a picnic together next Sunday at 11 o'clock in Stanmer Park. The guys who have done this spring, you remember the winter art stuff that was in here and this spring art stuff, are going to lead us through in some activity there in the park, and then we're going to eat our sandwiches together or whatever it is that you want to bring with you. 11 o'clock in Stanmer Park. It's in the email. It's got a what three words and a Google pin to tell you exactly where to go to. If you're not signed up for that email, get signed up, and you can come and speak to me afterwards, and I'll tell you exactly where in the park it is if you don't get the email. Is that okay? There is a minibus that's going from here at 10:30. If you need a lift, there are buses and you can cycle there and everything else. But if you need a lift, then come and speak to me. and I will write your name down somewhere and get on that minibus. That would be great. And I think the last thing, just for now, this is important. We're a Baptist church. We make major decisions together, and we made a major decision a couple of years ago around selling some property and buying another piece of property, and it's taken a bit of time to do that, and the Baptist Union, in their wisdom, have said, oh, too long has gone by, you need to ask the congregation again if it's okay. So that feels a little bit of a pain, but it might be that you've got some questions and you don't want us to sell our house. Well, there's your chance to get in the way of what's been such an easy process so far. So in two, not next Sunday, but the Sunday after, which is the 4th of July, 2nd of July, after the service, we'll finish the service, and then those who can stick around, it will be a short time. There are two things we're going to talk about. I'm going to talk about one of them in just a minute, but one of them will just be this legal thing where we have to say we're happy about property being bought and sold, and there'll be chances for you to ask questions about it. Is that okay? So that's going to happen in 2 weeks' time. I think that's it. So, children and young people, you've been amazing. Thank you for being with us. Anton, you're out with youth today. And everybody right down to in school age, there is stuff for you out here. If you've got a very little one and you want to sit somewhere close by, there's a little room just here. Or you can go and sit in the comfy chairs over there if you want to. But kids, go off to your activities. Have fun. I'm going to pray for our children as they go. God, we thank you for these amazing young lives. We're grateful for them. We're so grateful for their energy and their life. And for their provocation to do our lives better. So we pray for them today. Pray that they would have fun together, that they'd learn something together, that you'd give patience to the people looking after them, and they'd have a great time. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Are you doing okay? That went worse than I imagined. Are you doing okay? Yeah, good. Now, the Lord is the Spirit, And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Keep thinking around that theme. This is just a slight extension to the notice slot. Sorry, Mark, it shouldn't be too long. But we're going to sing again in a minute. But I just want to tell you about something that's come up that feels really exciting. One of the decisions that we made when we brought the two churches together years and years ago, both churches had what's called a manse or a vicarage in old language. And manse is an old language as well. And Becky and I live in one of them. And the other one was up in Patcham and we rented it out. And for years, the leadership team of the church said, wouldn't it be nice if we did something more? Housing is such an issue in Brighton. It's nice to get that income from renting it out, but wouldn't it be nice to do something more interesting with that other house? Just as we were really having those discussions, the tenant asked if they could buy the property, and it felt like a really good time to say, let's do that. So that money has sat in trust with the Baptist Union for a little while now, and we've been looking for the right opportunity. And it's kind of felt like we've tried a few things and we haven't really been sure. We've earned a bit of interest on it, it's been okay, but we've really wanted to do something more interesting. If you were at our last forum, I told you about one of the things we're looking at, and that's a project called Orchards. Orchards looks after women who are victims of sexual exploitation and gives them a safe house to be in. And so we're pressing on with that, and that's progressing, and we're really excited with that. So we're looking at buying a property, working with another organisation who has a bit more experience in this stuff around property. They're going to buy one, we're going to buy one, so there'll be two properties in Brighton. It feels like a really exciting thing, and we'll talk about that in a couple of weeks. But we've still got enough money to potentially buy another place, and Mark is going to just tell us about that. So thanks, Mark. Tell us about what this idea is.
Thanks, Dave. As Dave says, we've been, as trustees, we've been wanting, and as a community, actually, to use this property much more closely in line with our values. And an opportunity has come up to be part of a scheme called the Refugee Community Sponsorship Scheme, which is a community initiative. It's recognised by the Home Office, where if a community group forms with 12 to 15 people who commit to supporting a refugee family in their first year, 1 to 2 years of being resettled in the country, that effectively, and if they can find them accommodation and they can commit to supporting them to get into education and health, that effectively the community can take an extra refugee family than that would otherwise have been able to come. And news, this is a major challenge for our country, you know, for our world actually. And unfortunately, as a country, we're not doing very well. And even Brighton, for all of the will in the world, people want to, it's a very welcoming community, but because of housing, because of different challenges, actually Brighton hasn't been able to take the level of refugee families as actually I think the community would actually like to do. And we've spoken to Brighton Council. They would love us to do this scheme, because although there's over 150 of these schemes across the country that have been really successful, there hasn't actually been one yet in Brighton. And so we're wanting to form a group. We still need to work out a name for it. And effectively what we would do as one church is buy a property with some of the capital that Dave mentioned. And we would then rent that property to a family that we come and support being resettled in the country. And so that's kind of what we're proposing. Now, the challenge with this kind of thing is this is ultimately about a team effort, and we're looking for people who are interested to be part of that. And you can speak to me afterwards. We'll send out an email during the week about it as well. But it's a 1 to 2 year commitment, and it's about forming a group that will support this family as they come in. One of the reasons we've sort of jumped on it now a bit more quickly is because there's actually an opportunity of a family that we know who have fled Afghanistan about a year ago, just not long after the Taliban came, and they're in Pakistan now, and they've actually been granted asylum. There's some people that I worked with years ago, so I know their sort of backstory. They've been granted asylum in the UK and are waiting for accommodation. They're waiting for it to be resettled. And we've been told by the Home Office, if we did manage to bring a group together in time, we would actually be able to support this specific family. That would be brilliant, because we know the connections and we think they could do well there and we can support them. But But the important thing is that this is something we want to do as a community. And whether it's that family or a different one, that's what we're hoping to do. We'll talk about it a bit more in a couple of weeks' time at the forum as well, as we get through the technicalities of buying property. But this is really in line with what we decided, as Dave said, a year or two ago, that it's brilliant having these houses, it's brilliant getting income from it, but much better if we can do it in something that's really connected to our values. And so it's all been part of that journey.
Thank you, Mark. That's really great. So come and hear more about that. I think it nods towards something that Pete just said, that there are some societal issues where people can't express themselves freely because there is such obvious oppression around sexual exploitation of women, around war and displaced people. And it feels a very small thing, doesn't it? But wouldn't it be an amazing thing if in years to come we talked about the number of refugee families that had gone through this house, the number of women who we supported into a better, freer life with more opportunity and a greater belief in themselves because of that freedom that comes in the spirit. And so if you have any questions about that, or just as importantly, if you think maybe I could be part of that little team who become the little sponsoring group to support this initiative, then speak to Mark. That would be really good. We're going to sing again. But let's continue to pause for a minute, actually, and think about freedom. Think about the Spirit being in you. Think about how you've thought of the Spirit in your life. As we've been challenged over these few weeks to think about what the role of the Spirit is, my passion is for us to see that role in much bigger, cosmic kind of ways. I think we've narrowed down the Spirit to doing tricks in worship services sometimes, when actually the Spirit wants to bring freedom to the whole of creation, to exploited people, to normal, everyday people like us. God wants to bring freedom to through His Spirit. And Mark wrote a song a couple of weeks ago off the back of Pentecost, thinking about this wind that came and blew right at the beginning of the church. The beginning of the foundations of the church were a violent wind blowing away what was before, and a fire, this fire that came, and Mark reflected that. So we're just going to pause and we're going to listen to this song, and then I think you're going to invite us to join in a second song.
There's so much that I don't know, all these things I can't let go of. The time keeps marching on while I stand still. I was found, but now I have lost my way. Don't think I'm a wretch, but I still need your grace. Not blind, but maybe I just don't see how I used to. Spirit, come rushing like the wind and disturb my everything and fire. Fall and burn away my past. You are making me new. You are making me who I am. You are making me who I am. And it's been there all along, oh, constant regeneration, and I am changing to like the winter to spring. So Spirit, come rushing like the wind and disturb my everything and fire. Fall, burn away the past. You are making me new. You are making me who I am, you are making me who I am. And breathe in and breathe out, I am ready to find my heart and my soul and my peace of mind. Breathe in and breathe out, I am running into your love. So Spirit, come and rush in like the wind and disturb my everything, and fire, fire fall and burn away the past. You are making me who I am. Oh Spirit, come and rush in like the wind and disturb my everything, and fire, fire fall, burn away the past. You are making me new. You are making me who I am. You are making me who I am. You are making me who I am. You are making me who I am.
Let's stand together. We're going to sing a song called Who You Say I Am.
Who am I that the highest king would welcome? I was lost, but he bought me, you'd know his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. Last he has ransomed me, oh, his grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. The sun sets free, oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. Yes, I am who you say I am. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am. Who the Son? The sun sets free, oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am. I'm a child of God, yes I am.
I want us to continue thinking about freedom. And the starting point of that is to believe that God wants you to be free. And I don't want this to be just a kind of you-focused thing, but let's start there. Let's start with the thought that God wants you to be free. In fact, the purpose of Christ to come and die on the cross was about the liberation of all things. And sometimes we forget that. We think that it was a past event. It's a mysterious event. Sometimes we don't talk about it very much because it's so mysterious and because it's been weaponized and because it's been misunderstood. But fundamentally, my belief is that Jesus came to liberate. He came to do, to release the oppressed, to give sight to the blind, to release the prisoners, to declare the year of Jubilee. That's what Jesus said. The prophecy is fulfilled. I've come to do that. That Jesus' death on the cross and the outcome of it, and everything we've just sung about, is so that people can live freely. And the danger when we start to talk about, you know, do you feel free, or what does freedom look like for people, is that we begin to think about things like addiction. And I think it's really good to talk about addiction, actually, but the danger is that we tend to think about other people's addictions. And we think about the addictions that seem like obvious addictions. And when you think of an addict, you tend to think of alcohol, or you think of drugs, or you think of gambling, or you think of pornography, or you think of these kinds of things. All those things, I think we can agree, are not healthy things, are not things that are life-giving. They're destructive things. But just as we think about addiction, I want you to think about your addiction. Because I think the most dangerous type of addiction is the addiction that you don't know that you have. And the thing I want to keep coming back to, that freedom begins with the Holy Spirit revealing to you what it is that you need freedom from. And if you don't think you need freedom from anything, the chances are that your addiction is so deep that you just don't know that you have it. And if we'd had time, maybe even in your journey groups or times when you meet with others, it'd be a good question to talk about what are the addictions that are around us in our world today. What are the things that we are just so blind to because it's become like the air that we breathe? Oppressive and unhelpful systems that have us as addicts and we just don't know. Almost from the moment we were born, a rarefied kind of atmosphere that is constantly drip-feeding us messages that we respond to and we consider to be normal. And the thing I want to keep coming back to is the Holy Spirit as revelation. The Holy Spirit who brings wisdom into situations. And again, for some of you who grew up in the kind of charismatic tradition or been part of that, you know, things like having words of wisdom. And let's just have a time where, see who's got words of wisdom. I don't want to knock that per se, but I just want to try and expand it and just say it was too small. To be impressed that somebody had a word of knowledge for somebody, when actually I think the Spirit wants to give complete revelation of what's actually going on at a cosmic level to try and shake us out of our blindness and wake us up to what's actually going on in the world. The worst kind of addiction is the one that we don't know anything about. And there are things that I do in my life, I can't point the finger, I'll just talk about me for a moment, that I know are killing me. In terms of, if Christ has come to give me life in all its fullness, I have patterns of behavior that are the very opposite of life in all its fullness. Things that I know aren't good for me, I do. That seems to be a kind of biblical truth. People have these revelations and they're able to say, why do I keep doing the things that aren't good for me? And why am I so unable to do the things that I know are good for me? How do you break these patterns? That's an addiction, where you do something that you know is unhealthy, but you just do it anyway. And the insidious thing of the world around us saying, well, there isn't another way. This way that you're living that you're not finding much joy in, well, that just is the way of the world. That's just the way it is. These systems that I wish I could break, but they are just the system and there isn't another way. That's an addiction that is at its most dangerous. Things that crush us, things that enslave us, that don't give us joy, but we think we have to do because there isn't another way. The verse that we looked at. Now, the Lord is the Spirit, and the Spirit of the Lord. Well, I've got it wrong. And where? Come on, that was a test. And where the Spirit? Let's start again. Now, the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Let me read you the context to this, to that verse. And this is really just for me to be able to read. Sorry that it won't be very clear for you. But just listen to these words. And they're slightly complicated. There's a bit of a backstory that we're not going to go into loads of detail today. But just listen to where we find that verse. Since then, we have such a hope. Paul has been talking to the church in Corinth about hope, about freedom. And he says, since we have such a hope, we act with complete frankness, not like Moses, which is quite a statement, who put a veil over his face to keep the people of Israel from gazing at the end of the glory. That needs a bit of explanation if you're not used to this language. Some of you might know what he's talking about here. But he's referring to the point where Moses stands in front of God and he has the reflected glory of God. It's called the Shekinah glory, that when he comes down from the mountain, he's glowing because he's just spent time in the presence of God, a bit like Alice on the beach. You know, you're just glowing with good health. And because that starts to wear off, and he's looked himself in the mirror each day and goes, oh, I'm not radiating as much of God as I used to. I don't want people to know that. So he wore a veil so that people couldn't see him. He knew that the Shekinah glory was wearing off, but he wore this veil. Interesting kind of image, isn't it? So we can act with complete frankness, not like Moses, who put a veil over his face to keep the people of Israel from gazing at the end of the glory that was being set aside. But their minds were hardened. Indeed, to this very day, when they hear the reading of the old covenant, the same veil is still there. It is not unveiled, since in Christ it is set aside. Indeed, to this very day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their minds. But when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. All of us with unveiled faces, seeing the glory of the Lord as though reflected in a mirror, are being transformed into the same image, from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, the Spirit. I don't know if that makes much sense to you, but I just think that's a beautiful image. It's a clever piece of imagery. He's talking about someone with a veiled face. There's not many times that we wear veils. I haven't think I've ever worn a veil. But like weddings, people still wear veils, but not in front of their face generally. But this image of wearing a veil in front of your face does two things, doesn't it? It obscures people from seeing you for who you really are, and it means that you never see any of the world as it truly is, because there's a veil in front of your face. And the image that's given is freedom in Christ that the Spirit gives you is the ripping away of the veil so that you can be fully seen, but that you can also fully see. And that is the beginning of freedom. That's not freedom. It's the beginning of freedom. At the end of... just never use an example that you haven't written down first. But Nelson Mandela, Long Walk to Freedom by Nelson Mandela. I don't know if you've read that book. It's a fantastic book. Everyone should read that book. Amazing story of courage and fight to try and bring freedom for people. And right at the end, in fact, after it finished, he wrote an addendum later on. And in that addendum, he said that people keep saying to him, you did so much to bring freedom to the people of South Africa. And he said, I always say to them, that's just not true. Of course I didn't bring freedom. And we didn't bring freedom to the people of South Africa. But we gave the possibility of freedom to the people of South Africa. Now they have to make that choice. And the Holy Spirit cannot free you, but the Holy Spirit can give the possibility of freedom, because in revealing what it is that you are addicted to, that is suppressing the possibility of joy and freedom in you, in revealing what that is, that's the beginning of wisdom. Nobody wants to be told they have cancer. But in being told you have cancer, the possibility of living beyond cancer and dealing with cancer is suddenly open to you. The worst cancer is the cancer that you don't know that you have. Having that revelation of what is actually going on in my life is one of the offered gifts of the Spirit, and yet we so infrequently use it. And I feel like we talk about this a lot in this church, but it's unavoidable. That kind of revelation from the Holy Spirit only comes through contemplation and through stillness. It only comes with the intentionality of saying, I will be still and allow the Spirit to reveal to me. And I think it's the reason why so many people, including myself, avoid quiet times. Quiet times, not quiet times, registered trademark. Like times of quietness. Because maybe in the stillness, you start to be aware of some things that you don't want to be aware of, so you get busy again. But it's having the courage to face up to those things and to know what it is that is binding you that the freedom becomes a possibility. What kinds of addictions am I thinking of or talking about? Let me just name a few. You can name loads more, I'm sure, but I think we suffer in our society from addictions of stuff and money. It is an addiction for us that we don't know is there, that drives so much of what we do. And most of us go, well, I'm not a very materialistic person. That's not one of my addictions. Actually, I'm sorry, but we are just living. It is like the old fish talking to each other about what is water. That is the free market, neoliberal, consumerist society that you were born into. Bad luck. It's around you and it is insistent and you think it's normal and you think there is no other way. And the measurement of how worthy your job is on how much you're paid. And how successful you've been in your life is the size of your house or your car or whatever it might be. We like to say something different, but it is really hard to break out of that thought. Well, if I'm worth this, I'll be paid more. Why is that person paid more than me? Money is one of our addictions, and being free from it would be an amazing thing, but I don't know many people who are. Speed. Not back on drugs. I'm talking about pace. We're addicted to speed. I am absolutely addicted to speed. Might be one of my worst addictions. Don't isolate that and play it back somewhere to the Baptist Union. But I don't like shortcuts. I like shortcuts. I don't like going the full journey. I like to just get to the point. I don't want the slow process. I don't want to have to do the whole thing in my relationships. I just want my relationships to be brilliant now. I don't have to do the hard work when they aren't so good. All of us, we have this addiction to speed when the Spirit wants to do the slow, transformative work. Did anybody notice that last line in that verse? I just think it's beautiful. That we are being changed into the glory of God. 1 degree at a time. The myth of overnight Christian transformation, where my life was transformed. I'm sorry, I just don't believe it. I think you're pretty much the same as you were before. The best we can hope for is to just trust and believe that degree by degree by degree by degree, we're freeing ourselves from these addictions. You're never going to be fully free. But what would it look like to be a little bit more free of having to hurry, of trying to squeeze so much in, of trying to impress people with how much you're doing? One of my addictions is distraction. I just can't sit still and concentrate on anything. You know, Mary Oliver says that attention is the beginning of devotion. That's true in our relationships. that if you want to be devoted to somebody, you need to give them your attention. It's true of everything. And it's certainly true of our relationship with God. Worship begins with attention. Off myself. Attention onto someone else, but I am distracted. I'm addicted to image. I'm getting older. I care slightly less. I went to the off license in my Crocs the other day that are normally just house shoes, but it's a sign that I'm breaking the addiction of image. And I had socks on. And sorry, some of you are like, you've gone too far. But breaking these kinds of addictions, the image that what image am I presenting? That your ego is an addiction. I want people to think well of me. When actually there is only an audience of one that I want to think well of me, and he thinks I'm amazing. And how do you break these addictions? They're so insidious. They shape the way we dress, the way we hold ourselves, the places we go, the places we don't go. Imagine being free to actually do the thing that you intuitively want to do. My addiction of control. The futility of believing that I'm in control of anything. Surely we could be a generation that lived through a pandemic, that learnt the futility of trying to pretend that we're in control. We just don't know what's coming. You get a phone call at any moment. Either that or there's an ice cream van outside. That would be nice. All of these kinds of addictions, and the first step, you know, I know people in this community, and I know lots of people have gone through the 12 steps through Alcoholics Anonymous, like in this building and in our other building for years. Hundreds of groups have met. Cocaine Anonymous, Narcotics Anonymous, Alcoholics Anonymous have met in these small groups. It's one of the most beautiful acts of worship that happens in our church buildings. Because a group of people sit together, and what do? They introduce themselves to one another, and they acknowledge their addiction. There is a beautiful honesty. And suddenly, the possibility of their freedom comes about. And actually, that's not even the first step. It isn't going along to Alcoholics Anonymous that the first step. The first step is to say, I'm an alcoholic and I need help. That's the first step. And sometimes I feel envious of people who have such a solid thing that they are trying to deal with, because my insidious, more subtle things I know are around me, but I just can't quite grab them. But I need to be able to stand up and say, I'm Dave Steele, and I am a materialistic person, and I am too proud, and I am envious, and I am all these things, and I need help. And the Holy Spirit not only describes the cage that we're in, but the Spirit also points to the exit door, because there's always one. And it's being unaware of either of those things. The belief that the cage that you're in doesn't have an exit is untrue. The belief that you're in no kind of cage is also a myth. And I believe the Holy Spirit does these two beautiful jobs. Gently and without judgment, but gently before the Spirit, describing some of the things that you can be free from. The Spirit reveals them. There's a guy called Father Gregory Boyle, and he said one of my favorite things I've heard for years, but he says this: when you encounter the God of love, fire all the other gods. It's a great line, isn't it? And I think that these addictions and these other things are basically our gods. The things that we give time to and we pay homage to are the things that we worship. And they become our idols, and they become our gods. But those idols all have something in common. They all want you. They all want to destroy you. When you meet the God of love, fire all the other gods. When we look at the first commandment where it says, you should have no other gods before me, the danger is we interpret that as this egotistical maniac in the sky screaming at us, you shall have no other gods before me. But actually, if you can change that image to a loving parent who says, all the other gods are not for you, I am. Turn your life towards me. Give your life to the kingdom, and all other things shall follow. You'll be rich beyond measure. Your life will be abundant. You will have joy if you come to me. And the kind of God that he is, and the love of God, and the God of love, is the love that frees us. And I just want to finish with talking about oppression. I've sort of nodded to it already, but addiction are the things that we do. Oppression are the powers that force these addictions upon us when we don't even know them. We don't even know they're doing it. But there are powers at work in the world. And we've used words like evil, and we've given them personification like the devil and everything else. And it's confusing. My belief is that there are powers that are against the good well-being of humanity and the earth. And it's hard to name them, and they're not any one person, but they exist. And the Holy Spirit can reveal those things. We talked about refugees, and we talked to, it makes you think, therefore, about war and the powers that have caused the war and the scarcity with people running away because they no longer have enough, and people arriving on boats on our shores and the rhetoric that goes with that. There are powers at work that are forcing people into that kind of behavior. There are these powers at work, and we are asking the Spirit to reveal those things to us. And these are broader, more complex things. But we need to stand against the oppressive powers. Desmond Tutu, I think, quoting someone else, famously talked about that we've got to stop just pulling the bodies out of the river. We have to go upstream and find out who's pushing them in the first place. And that's what we should be doing. It's all very well knowing that the system is broken, but why is the system there, and is another system possible? This is radical stuff, and it's to do with what Spirit-filled people do, where the revelation of the Spirit allows us to go upstream and to know what's going on. We've talked quite a lot about this reading room. It's just some books on a shelf. But what do those books have in common? They are disruptive books. They don't have the answers, really. They're just books. But in these books, people are trying to explain, why is it we've got the broken systems we've got? Why is it that women are treated this way? Why is it that children are treated this way? Why is it people from different races are treated this way? How can we break these things? Because there are other ways. The kingdom of God is the other way. The kingdom of God is not complicit in slavery. It's to free the slaves. And the revelation of the Holy Spirit does this ability to reveal to us. And I wish we were a church full of people who gave words of wisdom. Not, there's a man with an orange t-shirt who's got a lower back problem. Sorry, that was a bit naughty of me. But not a kind of individual. I'm talking about, like, when we sat here for the launch of the, I don't know, Sam talked about this, but I was so transfixed with this short woman from Colombia who has had death threats on her life because she's seen her community devastated by mega mining, where members of her family have been killed, where children have been murdered because the expansion of mining in her country. And she stood on the stage and she spoke in Spanish. And they did this incredible, the woman doing the interpretation was amazing because they did this long-form interpretation where she spoke for 5 or 7 minutes. And then the interpreter summarized everything that she just said. But actually, she didn't need to interpret it. The justice and the passion was all over this woman. She was full of the Holy Spirit. She didn't use any of that language, but her demand for justice for her community was so beautiful and so profound. People are signing up there and then before the translation has happened, because that's what the Spirit does. Moves us to make change, to strike for justice, to speak out, to stand up, to come out of our comfort zone, have the comfort to do that, have the confidence to do that. I know it's a little thing, but Willow and Rose standing here, the Holy Spirit's moving in them. I want the world to continue to be beautiful. It's a little thing, but it's better than sitting there going, well, it's just the way it is. There's not much you can do. There are things we can do. I'm going to finish by playing you a song, which is a piece of spoken word. And maybe I need to apologize that it's Kay Tempest again, but I am free to choose whatever I like. So stuff you. And so we're going to listen to Kay Tempest. And three different people in the last 2 weeks have sent me this piece of work by Kay Tempest, which is really weird because it's I think it's at least 3 or 4, maybe 5 years old. So it's like, okay, I get the message. We're gonna listen to this. And one of the things that they say in the spoken word is, they take us for idiots, but that's their problem. When we behave like idiots, it becomes our problem. And they say, hold your own. And it's a brilliant, brilliant piece of wordplay. Because the first time you hear it, you might just think that they're referring to holding your own people. And they do refer to that at one point. But they're also saying, hold your own. Hold the ground that you're on. Hold yourself. There are forces around you that are trying to push you and pull you to consume, to look like this, to behave this way. But you're free. So hold your own. Hold your ground. Hold strong. Every significant move in civil society has happened because somebody somewhere has gathered people around them and has held their own, has said, the housing problem in Brighton is so ridiculous and it's so expensive. What could you possibly do to change it? You want to do 100 houses. What's the point in doing one? Well, if that's all we can do right now, let's just do one. If all you can do is just something small, do that. Hold your own. Speak up for people without a voice. Stand up for what you believe in, because that is freedom. This isn't a God with a stick saying you must. It's a God who's saying you're free. And when you're truly free, the very most obvious response is to offer that freedom to other people too. What do you need freedom from today?
But when time pulls lives apart, hold your own. When everything is fluid, nothing can be known with any certainty, hold your own. Hold it till you feel it there, as dark and dense and wet as earth, as vast and bright and sweet as air. When all there is knowing that you feel what you are feeling. Hold your own. Ask your hands to know the things they hold. I know the days are reeling past in such squealing blasts, but stop for breath and you will know it's yours. Swaying like an open door when storms are coming, hold. Time is an onslaught, love is a mission. We work for vocations until in remission we wish we'd had patience and given more time to our children. Feel each decision that you make. Make it, hold it, hold your own. Hold your lovers, hold their hands. Hold their breasts in your hands like your hands were their bra. Hold their face in your palms like a prayer. Hold them all night, feel them. Hold back, don't hold back. Hold your own. Every pain, every grievance, every stab of shame, every day spent with a demon in your brain giving chase, hold it. Know the wolves that hunt you. In time, they will be the dogs that bring your slippers. Love them right, and you will feel them kiss you when they come to bite. Hot snouts digging out your cuddles with their bloody muzzles. Hold. Nothing you can buy will ever make you more whole. This whole thing thrives on us feeling always incomplete. And it is why we will search for happiness in whatever thing it is we crave in the moment. And it is why we can never really find it there. It is why you will sit there with the lover that you fought for in the car you sweated years to buy, wearing the ring you dreamed of all your life. And some part of you will still be unsure that this is what you really want. Stop craving. Hold your own. But if you're satisfied with where you're at, with who you are, you won't need to buy new makeup or new outfits or new pots and pans to cook new exciting recipes for new exciting people to make yourself feel like the new exciting person you think you're supposed to be. Happiness, the brand, is not happiness. We are smarter than they think we are. They take us all for idiots, but that's their problem. When we behave like idiots, it becomes our problem. So hold your own. Breathe deep on a freezing beach. Taste the salt of friendship. Notice the movement of a stranger. Hold your own and let it be catching.
Significantly better sermon than mine, but hold your own and let it be catching. It's beautiful, isn't it? We're going to sing as our way of doing something together as we finish our time. But I just want to encourage you to live freely, to have moments in your week where you find a bit of space to just say to God's Spirit, where am I not free? Where are you pointing to the door to freedom? Who do I know who is lacking freedom? And is there anything I can do to aid their freedom? Is there any system that I can break, small or big, this week that is oppressive, that's brought addiction to people? Let me be free, let others live free. Let's stand together if you'd like to, and let's sing.
This is a song that we haven't sung here before, but sort of made up of a few different bits that are repeated and hopefully fairly easy to pick up. So we'll sing it and invite you to sing after.
You are the light, song of my life. You always lead. You are the voice inside. You are my love. No one before you, all that I am points to you.
You are the light.
You are the light, the song of my life. You always lead. You are the voice inside. You are my love. No one before you, all that I am points to you, and I was made by you, and I was made for you, and I am unfulfilled without full communion.
We'll sing that again. I was made by you.
And I was made by you. And I was made for you. And I am unfulfilled without full communion.
You are the light again.
You are the light, song of my life. You always lead. You are the voice inside. You are my love. No one before you. All that I am points to you. I was made by you, and I was made for you. communion. This is Bridget goes. So since your love got a hold of me, since your love got a hold of me, I'm a new creation. I'm forever changed. Oh, since your love got a hold of me, since your love got a hold of me, I'm a new creation. I'm forever changed. Oh, since your love got a hold of me, since your love got a hold of me, I'm a new creation. I'm forever changed. Oh, since your love got a hold of me, since your love got a hold of me, I'm a new creation. I'm forever changed, and I was made by you. And I was made for you. And I am unfulfilled without full communion. In you is all I need. You're my breath, you're my life, you're my everything. In you is all I need. You're my breath, you're my life, you're my everything. In you is all I need. You're my breath, you're my life, you're my everything. In you is all I need. You're my breath, you're my life, you're my everything. In you is all I need. You're my breath, you're my life, you're my everything. In you is all I need. You're my breath, you're my life, you're my everything. In you is all I need. You're my breath, you're my life, you're my everything. In you is all I need. You're my breath, you're my life, you're my everything.
Kept being reminded of a line of a poem when I was speaking, and I thought I'd never find it, but I just very quickly did. So it's a very, very short poem by Mary Oliver. It says, things, burn them, make a beautiful fire. More room in your heart for love, for the trees, for the birds who own nothing, the very reason they can fly. God, I pray for us as much as I pray for myself. I pray that we would know what it is to have nothing and yet live in abundance. To have joy, not just our own joy, but joy because we're seeing freedom come to others too. And God, I pray in your spirit that you would do that work of revealing. Help us to know what that means. Help us to know where to begin in even asking. But reveal to us the things that are stopping us having life in all its fullness. Help us to live in families and in homes and in neighborhoods where the currency is patience and kindness and joy and love. And help us to be part of bringing that, your kingdom, as it is in heaven, here to earth, I pray. Free us, Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Thanks for being here today. We often finish by saying the words of the grace. Let's say these words together. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Amen. Have a seat. Thanks so much for being here. Do snap up those last cakes. You could probably plant a tree without buying a cake. I think that you're free to do that. By giving them some money for that, that would be great, or planting your own trees. And if you can stick around afterwards for the community meal, that would be really good too. Thanks so much.